Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Norman Conquest in English History, Volume 1, A Broken Chain, by George Garnett, narrated by Nigel Patterson. Introduction. From 1066, successive Norman kings of the English presented themselves as the old English royal line continued. They came close to glossing over the fact that the kingdom had been conquered at all. Their legitimacy as kings was founded on an official version of certain key events, or rather alleged events, primarily of the 1050s and 1060s. Very quickly, this version of recent history became intrinsic to the operations of the new regime. This was already the case prior to the first extant written statement of Duke William's claim to the throne of England, in William of Jumièges' Gesta Normannorum Ducum, circa 1071. In the name of continuity with Edward the Confessor's England, this version of events played an important part in shaping the way in which the kingdom was brutally transformed, most fundamentally in terms of who held land on what terms, and most visibly in terms of architecture. Domesday Book was the monumental written consummation of the tendentious premise that nothing had changed since King Edward's day, at least so far as tenurial structure was concerned. Many of the individual tenants, clerical as well as lay, might be different, but they all held as successors of Edwardian antecessores, and the tenurial system was presented as unaltered. The book purported to be an objective record of facts, most importantly the corresponding facts for any particular tenancy at two fixed points, now, in 1086, and in the time of King Edward, meaning on the 5th of January 1066, the day of Edward's death. This chronological framework, first formulated many years before the Domesday Survey had been conceived, meant that the book embodied an official history which was already deeply entrenched by 1086. The consequences of the transformation in the Kingdom of England, which had been administered by reference to that interpretation of the past, were so fundamental that they continued to set the context of politics in the 12th century and in some respects long afterwards. 20 years after 1066, Domesday Book was the most substantial early treatment of change over the conquest, but change disguised as continuity with the old English past. This study addresses many subsequent treatments in different forms of the same issue over a far longer timescale. It considers the roles that the Norman Conquest played in English historical writing, in English law, and in English political argument over a period from circa 1090 to circa 1700. The subject has proved to be so vast that it has been necessary to divide the study into two volumes. This first volume takes the story up to the point in the early 17th century, when the bulk of what were then recognised as the most important sources on the conquest, and what had preceded it, had become widely available in print. The second volume will begin a little earlier than the end of the first. It will examine the use made of these materials in scholarship and in political debate from the later years of Elizabeth's reign into and through the 17th century, when the conquest rapidly became an even more contested issue than it had been in the 12th. This first volume opens by showing how and why, within 40 years of 1066, a number of writers suddenly and almost simultaneously began to write Latin histories not just of their own monastic houses, but of England. Almost all of them were demonstrably monastic precentors, so in charge of libraries, record-keeping and liturgy in their communities. Ex officio, they found themselves at the nub of establishing and demonstrating continuity over the conquest. They were obliged to play a key part in dealing with the implications of the comprehensive rebuilding of the kingdom's major churches, most pressingly establishing which saints' relics merited translation from the old into the new churches. They also had to ensure that their institutions' titles to estates were reliably documented, in a context where traditional titles to land, like traditional claims to sanctity, were subject to newly intense, sceptical scrutiny. The scale of the demolition and construction work which surrounded them must have constituted an even more insistent daily reminder of transformation than the intermittent threats to ancient landed possessions. In diverse locations around the kingdom, these writers appear to have recognised that it was necessary to reconstruct, or more accurately to construct, a history of England which traversed the conquest and reached back at least as far as the conversion to Christianity of the Angles and Saxons, collectively termed the English, at the very end of the 6th century and beginning of the 7th. In doing so, they were well aware that they were resurrecting a literary genre which, to most intents and purposes, appeared to have died out in this island with the demise of Bede, the great historian of the conversion, almost 4 centuries before. Bede's shadow fell on each of them in a different way, but they were all acutely conscious that they were writing in it. Each, after his own fashion, sought to provide an historiographical continuation, or, in Geoffrey of Monmouth's revealingly exceptional case, prologue, to Bede's Historia Ecclesiastica Gentis Sanglorum, which the intervening centuries had lacked. They did not work in isolation. Many of them were demonstrably aware of what their peers were up to. Precentors in different houses were obliged to correspond with each other by one of their official duties, the commemoration of the dead. William of Malmesbury, by his own estimation and that of posterity the preeminent member of this select group, and certainly the most learned in classical literature, neatly formulated the point in a metaphor he adapted from the late antique model provided by the preface to Justinus's epitome of the otherwise lost histories of Pompeius Trogus. English historical writing was a chain which had been broken with the death of Bede. William and his contemporaries, Eadmer of Canterbury, Florence and John of Worcester, Simeon of Durham, and the secular canon and archdeacon Henry of Huntingdon being the most prominent at the time and subsequently, were attempting to forge a long new section of chain to be linked to what had been left dangling in 735. For reasons discussed in Chapter 1, it seems likely that they were right to think that Latin historical writing in England had all but died out after Bede. Why this should have happened here, in striking contrast to West and later East Francia, to Italy and Iberia, is a very interesting question, which has scarcely been touched upon by modern historians of the Anglo-Saxon period. An obvious factor is likely to have been the continuing and unique importance of the written vernacular throughout the various kingdoms of England. This was still very much the case after the English kingdom had been formed in the early 10th century. Indeed, it remained so until the half-century after the conquest, when written Old English quickly became obsolescent as a language of legislation, administration, and devotion. But why the role of the vernacular might have made English monks disinclined to write history in Latin is not immediately apparent. History was an antique genre, so it was probably difficult to conceive of writing it, as distinct from the rudimentary and often shambolic vernacular annals of the various manuscripts of the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, initiated at the end of the 9th century, in anything other than an antique language. The explanation for history's post-Bedan demise in England is unlikely to be simple. To provide a fully satisfactory one for this particular instance of English exceptionalism would require a quite different book from that which follows. The question arises because the sudden efflorescence of English historiography about England at the start of the 12th century threw into striking relief the long antecedent hiatus which William of Malmesbury sought to characterise in the metaphor he borrowed and adapted from a Roman historian of the later empire. That dramatic and in the event collaborative outburst, which burned most brightly in the second quarter of the century, is the subject of the opening 2 chapters. In the view of William and his contemporaries, writing the history of England and the English necessarily involved filling the post-Bedan gap, and in most cases also recapitulating in summary form much of Bede's Historia Ecclesiastica. Several of them also suggested that the Norman conquest had represented some sort of break in the course of English history, as distinct from English historical writing. the conquest was generally interpreted as a rupture of a magnitude exceeding that caused by any earlier invasion. But insofar as they felt the need to repair it, to trace connections with what had preceded it, they were obliged to mend the historiographical chain which had been broken many centuries before it. Almost all of them were members of institutions which had survived it, and most were charged with establishing and recording aspects of the continuous life of their churches stretching back into the distant past. For this reason, a study of the conquest's role in the germination of English historiography about England necessarily involves a consideration not only of the treatment of the conquest itself by these historians, but also of their awareness that they were writing up for the first time most of English history in the interval between the death of Bede and the immediate aftermath of the conquest. Mending the historical chain involved mending the historiographical chain. It is striking that one difference between Eadmer's Historia Novorum, the earliest of these works, and those which followed, was that he did not attempt to mend the latter chain. He was concerned with explaining what the conquest had changed and why, not with writing a sequel to Bede, though he was acutely conscious of the Bedean model of ecclesiastical history. He opened his account not in the early 8th century, but in the second half of the 10th, in the reign of Edgar. In his view, it offered a model of equable collaboration between king and prelacy, in counterpoint to the tension which had come to prevail in the aftermath of the conquest. Things had begun to go awry long before, shortly after Edgar's death, with the sacrilegious outrage of the assassination of his son and immediate successor, Edward the Martyr. That abomination had brought God's wrath down on the heads of the English. The conquest had been the latest and most devastating in a succession of divinely ordained afflictions. There could be no certainty that it would turn out to be the last. Eadmer's immediate historiographical successors expressed enormous admiration for his book and drew on it. Some of them evidently sympathised with his assessment of the conquest as providential punishment for sin, Old Testament style. But none of them borrowed his starting point. Although, like him, they were attempting to explain the conquest, unlike him, this prompted them in their various ways to try to mend the broken historiographical chain. Their research excavated and preserved most of what we know about Old or Anglo-Saxon England, and organised it in a fashion which has proved definitive ever since. In that sense, pre-conquest English history was largely created from a post-conquest perspective, with the inevitable consequence of reading current early 12th century preoccupations back into the Anglo-Saxon past. We are all familiar with the beyond, meaning the retrospective extrapolation of Doomsday Book. Something similar is more self-consciously true of the great historians of England who wrote in the half-century after the book's production. In parallel with this intense, concentrated historiographical phenomenon, unparalleled in medieval Europe and in terms of analytical influence throughout subsequent English history, was a simultaneous attempt to unearth, preserve, translate, and to a considerable extent to invent Old English royal law, conventionally termed, after the conquest, the Law of King Edward, Chapter 3. This William the Conqueror was said and shown, by and large, to have endorsed, much like other aspects of the Edwardian status quo. It was a further manifestation of continuity with Old England. The research project into pre-conquest law was much more focused in terms of subject than that into pre-conquest history. It was, however, less concentrated in terms of duration. It was still in train in the 13th century. By contrast with the historiographical project, the names of the scholars who engaged in it are unknown, or can only be guessed at. But it reached back just as far into the Old English past, and it was animated by similar imperatives. Sometimes its products appeared in the same manuscripts as the histories. Sometimes they were clumsily spliced into the very text of the histories. Often they were written up in law books, which contained no accompanying historical narrative. Precentors who were charged with record-keeping and drafting documents were likely to be sensitive to legal matters, and were also likely to appreciate that they sometimes required awareness of an historical dimension. But those who engaged in this highly specialized type of research and fabrication are unlikely to have been precentors, because precentors' professional responsibilities did not involve the use of royal legislative texts, as distinct from royal charters and writs. They may have needed to consult from time to time the glossaries of Old English technical terms, which were compiled in the 12th century, partly on the basis of the codes. But that is quite a different matter from compiling, translating, or confecting codes, which in any case say almost nothing about land law. The resulting collections of genuine and apocryphal Old English codes, often translated with varying levels of competence into Latin, together with various codified versions of what purported to be the conqueror's legislation, are conventionally judged to have been quite rapidly superseded by the results of a series of new legal procedures invented in the later 12th century. It is these new procedures which we now see as the origins of English common law. They are generally considered to have represented a fresh start, and not in any sense to be dependent on the antiquated and moribund legislative relics of Old England, or what in the early 12th century was considered to have been Old English law. One of the claims advanced in just a moment is that many of the collections, most especially what purported to be the laws of King Edward, which William I was said to have endorsed, imaginatively reconstructed in a number of pseudo-codes, one of which is the earliest extant law code in French, continued to be recognised as an important foundation of current law, and therefore to exert influence throughout the rest of the Middle Ages and later. These texts, still revered and consulted for current purposes in the 14th and 15th centuries, as shown in chapters 5, 6 and 7, could not but import interpretation of the conquest into current jurisprudence, and therefore contemporary politics. Moreover, for other and very particular reasons, the conquest remained a point of reference in certain types of forensic proceedings. A case involving ancient domain, a category invented in the 13th century, but deemed by definition to date from before the conquest, hence ancient, could only be settled by reference to Domesday Book, Chapter 6. Exceptionally, the book might also be consulted in other types of case. Ancient charters were occasionally quoted and more rarely brandished in court. Although the limit of legal memory came to be fixed at Richard I's coronation, that did not prevent the occasional invocation of documents dating from much earlier. By the second half of the 12th century, there were then two categories of text written or at least compiled and translated in the first half of that century: histories and legal compilations. Both bore upon the long history of Old England and the conquest which had or had not terminated it. Counterintuitively, it was the more narrowly focused legal tradition which was to do more to preserve the conquest as an issue of debate or dispute during the later Middle Ages. The extraordinary richness of English historical writing in the first half of the 12th century was not sustained in the second, even by the decreasing number of historians who continued to attempt to cover the full range of English history. From the 13th century, there was a growing tendency to concentrate on the recent past, or on the history of a particular church, or on universal history, in which 11th century England could claim only a minor part. Very occasionally, some arresting and unsubstantiated episode from 1066 or its immediate aftermath was recounted, chapters 4 and 5. But on the whole, and insofar as the conquest continued to be considered at all, existing accounts were simply cut and pasted, and usually heavily condensed, from earlier treatments. The conquest became a convenient starting point for histories which aspired to cover more than the very recent past, but that did not mean that much was said about it. It had become a familiar punctuation mark in the course of English history. It did not need to be revisited and probed, just briefly summarised. By contrast, translated collections of Old English codes, and the post-conquest confections to varying extents based upon them, continued to be copied, especially in London, and not just in the city's churches. That recent pieces of legislation were appended piecemeal to a London compilation of these materials, known as the London Collection of the Leges Anglorum, strongly suggests that it was not manufactured in order to satisfy an interest in legal antiquarianism amongst the upper echelons of the city's administration. Most of these officials were unlikely to have been of scholarly bent. The earliest extant witness of the collection, dating from the start of John's reign, was designed both to impress and to be of practical use. That use was not confined to municipal matters, because the collection treated the city as the kingdom on a small scale, and the kingdom as the city on a grand scale. The city was said to be the kingdom's caput. The collection was addressed not only urbi, but also regno. It secured the attention of both these projected audiences, which overlapped to a considerable degree. It appears to have played an important part in expressing and informing opposition thinking in the years immediately prior to Magna Carta. What was now for the first time unequivocally termed the Coronation Charter of Henry I and the Law of King Edward, which that document had repeatedly endorsed, were turned against Henry I's great-grandson and successor to telling effect, Chapter 4. This adroit piece of political manoeuvring was of such great interest to historians of John's reign that some of them began to see Henry I's charter being invoked everywhere, even on occasions when it demonstrably was not. King John himself became so obsessed with it that in early 1215 he attempted to demand that every free man in the kingdom swear an oath specifically against it when he was obliged to renew his fealty to the king. In the 1230s, John's son and successor, Henry III, eventually reappropriated Edward the Confessor for royalty. But he did so by sumptuous elaboration of the saint's cult established under Henry II, most spectacularly in the new Abbey Church, which he constructed at Westminster to replace Edward's own building. In it, he would eventually be interred beside the splendid new shrine which he had commissioned for the royal saint. In this devotional expression of continuity with Old England, the focus was entirely on Edward as saint, not Edward as lawgiver, Chapter 4. It was epitomised in the coronation ceremony, during which a new king was invested with regalia now identified as those of the Confessor. The evocation of St. Edward rendered the current king's image more numinous, but Henry III tacitly acknowledged that Edward's law was unlikely ever again to buttress the assertion of royal power. That implicit concession had left open the possibility of again deploying against other kings the texts devised for and attributed to Edward in the 12th century, just as they had been against John. This is exactly what happened in the reign of Edward II, named like his father after their canonised predecessor. In a sleight of genius, the laws of St. Edward were inserted into the coronation ceremony itself, in the form of a new promise on the part of the king to respect them. The ceremonial proclamation of the king's affinity with his only canonised predecessor also became the means by which he was made to bind himself to respect the saint's laws. A century or so after its first compilation, the London collection enjoyed a renaissance which, to judge from the number of surviving copies, was even more influential than it had been in its first Johannine incarnation, Chapter 7. Despite the title devised for it by modern historians, the London collection was not confined to the city where it had first been put together. Its wider pertinence was betokened by the parallel it drew between city and kingdom. Its distinctive version of the Leges Edwardi Confessoris not only proved peculiarly serviceable to Edward II's opponents, it was drastically edited and spliced into a history written in Lichfield, probably just after the end of Edward's reign, in order to provide the template of an account of the conquest. Similarly, texts from other 12th century compilations of pre- and immediately post-conquest royal legislation were, in the 14th and 15th centuries, inserted into the idiosyncratic narratives of the conqueror's reign written in monasteries in Leicestershire and Lincolnshire. The codes which were selected for inclusion in these histories were principally those apocryphal ones which purported to record the conqueror's endorsement of Old English law. The focus was, in other words, on the nature of the conquest, on King William's supposed determination that it should not alter much, legally speaking. As demonstrated in Chapter 5, however, a very early 12th century collection of translated Old English codes, Quadripartitus, was adapted, probably in Yorkshire, to provide the framework for a substantial history of England from the conversion to the aftermath of the conquest. For this, laws of Edward the Confessor had to be freshly concocted, because there was no code attributed to Edward in Quadripartitus. Ancient royal law codes, translated from Old English into Latin, or fabricated for the conqueror in the 12th century, provided in these exceptional provincial late medieval histories the substance of analytical treatments of the conquest, which in all other respects were in this period rudimentary and hackneyed. Very occasionally, the codes also continued to be drawn upon in jurisprudential literature. But in this period, common law jurisprudence became increasingly technical and specialised, and was, from the late 13th century, written for the most part in the curious law French, which lawyers would eventually come to consider one of the few lasting legacies of the conquest. This meant that it tended to be confined to a small professional audience, and therefore to be of limited influence. Sir John Fortescue, who in the second half of the 15th century explicitly discussed the conquest, albeit to endorse the conventional doctrine of legal continuity, was in this respect very much an exception amongst later medieval English jurists writing about English law. But his purpose was political, to contrast royal rule in England and France, always to the detriment of the latter. In these ways, the conquest limped along as a topic of interest, or at least of reference, in later medieval England. In the late 13th century, Earl Warren might have been unusually belligerent as a defendant when he brandished his ancestral rusty sword rather than a royal charter in the midst of court proceedings, Chapter 6. But his irate defence of a title to land he claimed to derive from the conquest would have resonated with his peers. It was and remained a mark of distinction to assert descent from one who had come over with the conqueror, and or tenure of an ancestral estate from that time. Most churches could establish title which was far more ancient. The primary position of Henry III's 1225 reissue of Magna Carta in most collections of statutes, its role in 13th, 14th and early 15th century politics, and in legal education throughout that period and subsequently, all raised questions about the antecedent problem, the mischief, for which this allegedly first extant statute had been designed as a remedy. As with the original Magna Carta of 1215, so later, with this legally authoritative version, the document could be interpreted not as an innovation, but as the restoration of an earlier legal status quo. That status quo was embodied in the law of King Edward, which the conqueror had or had not endorsed, the law which some of his successors might have failed to maintain, the law which kings from Henry III to Henry V had reaffirmed by repeatedly reissuing or endorsing the charter. It was a law which was deemed to be embodied in the ancient royal law codes, both authentic and apocryphal. Although Magna Carta of 1225 came to be accepted as the first statute, these codes were reassuringly much more statute-like in form. The precondition for the resurrection of the conquest as a matter of current concern and relevance was the Reformation, and particularly the dissolution of the monasteries. The revival did not come to pass immediately. Henry VIII and his close advisers were very interested in adducing precedents for English royal control over the clergy and the exclusion of papal claims to jurisdiction in the kingdom. Many of the best precedents could be adduced from pre- and immediately post-conversion British history, fewer from later in the Middle Ages. The version of the 12th century fabrication known as Leges Edwardi Confessoris, found in the London collection of the Leges Anglorum, became for a third time an important authority during the early 1530s, but on account of its imaginative recreation of aspects of very early British history, not of William I's endorsement of King Edward's law. This was the first occasion on which it was deployed in support of a king's pretensions, rather than against them. The king himself signalled his enthusiasm for Henry of Huntingdon's Historia Anglorum, perhaps because it had the twin advantages that it was easier to find one's way around than either of William of Malmesbury's great histories, and that Henry's Latin was far more readily comprehensible. Henry's Historia was attractive because it provided a more straightforwardly structured account of the conversion and its aftermath than Bede. The Leges Edwardi Confessoris, Henry of Huntingdon's Historia, and the works of William of Malmesbury, like many other books bearing on the history of England which had been suddenly dispersed from monastic libraries, were all products of the great outpouring of attempts in the 12th century to make sense of English history. Although at this stage their treatment of the conquest was not of much interest, their construction of English history in general and of the history of English law in particular was informed by their post-conquest perspective, as I have already emphasised. The conquest had been both their inspiration and their defining premise. Any reading more attentive than the highly selective official filleting in the early 1530s for ancient precedents preserved in the official collection of useful historical precedents known as the Collectania Satis Copiosa, Chapter 7, was likely sooner or later to draw attention to the subject. Most of the materials being searched treated it and had been written in response to it. The dispersal of these books in the 1530s, 40s, and 50s, and their selective preservation, often by a small subset of those officials charged with administering the dissolution, Chapter 8, poachers turned bibliophilic gamekeepers, created the potential for them to be used as sources if and when the conquest should again become a subject of current interest. A fortiori, this was the case, when these works, recognised as definitive for the early history of England in modern attempts, such as Polydore Vergil's, to rewrite that history, were rendered much more widely accessible by the new technology of printing. Some of those who scooped up manuscript histories and law books foresaw the potential. Elizabeth I's first Archbishop of Canterbury, Matthew Parker, not only instigated his own central record of who held manuscript witnesses of which medieval books, with a particular interest in those which bore on the history of the kingdom, he also started the process of producing printed editions of them. In quick succession, he published two editions of Matthew Paris, selected for that historian's highly congenial hostility to papal interference in English affairs. In terms of printed editions, however, Old English and immediately post-conquest law codes stole a march. William Lambard's scholarly edition, produced in collaboration with Lawrence Noel, was first printed in 1568, Chapter 9. Both scholars were closely associated with Archbishop Parker, who was active too in facilitating legal antiquarianism. He was uncharacteristically demonstrative about his pride in owning and commissioning supplements to a 12th-century collection of English law codes, which will reappear frequently throughout this study. This is the manuscript now known as London British Library Manuscript Additional 49366, and often referred to as the Hocombe Book, because it passed from Parker's library into that of Sir Edward Coke, and thence into the library of the house which his descendants built at Hocombe. There it remained until the mid-20th century. The frontispiece he commissioned for the book provides the frontispiece for this volume. The great historical works of the early 12th century and the later medieval resumes of them were very selectively digested in Polydore Vergil's Historia Anglicana, first printed in 1534, and in Holinshed's Vernacular Chronicles, first printed in 1577, and reissued in a much expanded edition 10 years later. But the texts themselves did not begin to be printed until the early 1590s, by which point the medieval English past, in the shape of Magna Carta, had already begun to be resurrected as a figure in political debate. Thereafter, publications swiftly followed. Many of the most important were available by the time King James VI of Scotland succeeded Elizabeth on the English throne in 1603. Most of the rest followed over the next 50 years, Chapter 10. Bare texts of narratives were published, taken from manuscripts which came to hand, with individual witnesses sometimes being used as copy texts for the printers. Initially, there was little or nothing in the way of scholarly apparatus. Antiquarian editorial scholarship rapidly developed in sophistication, but of necessity, scholars had to devise methods from scratch. They were feeling their way. In this regard, too, the legal antiquarians Noel and Lambard had already displayed great precocity in the 1560s. This volume concludes with a consideration of John Selden's 1623 edition of Viadma's Historia Novorum, which was in itself, appropriately enough, a novelty in terms of scholarly editions of historiographical texts. In his unprecedentedly substantial scholarly apparatus, Selden integrated the fruits of the work of these and other legal antiquaries in order to illuminate Eadmer's text. Innovative as was his use of the work of other legal historians, however, it is striking that he did not seek out what we now know to be the autograph witness of Eadmer's book, available in Archbishop Parker's library. It seems highly improbable that Selden was unaware of the existence of this manuscript, which had been repeatedly transcribed in the 16th century and cited in printed books he must have read. It may have been that his incarceration in the Tower of London during the period when he was preparing the edition hampered his access to certain books, though the richness of citation of other works would suggest that this was not generally the case. Whatever his reasons, for the printed text of Historia Novorum, he contented himself with a much later witness, which had by then found its way into the library of his friend Robert Cotton. It seems that Selden was far more interested in using Eadmer's book as a pretext to explore aspects of legal history related to the conquest than he was in establishing a definitive critical text. When it came to legal materials, he made a point of parading his paleographical virtuosity. James VI of Scotland's accession to the English throne had been widely interpreted as analogous to a conquest of England. It had been so because the ruler of one kingdom was acquiring another, an event which was seen as having particular implications for the extent of his powers in the realm he had just acquired. Inevitably, the analogy directed attention to the Norman Conquest, by far the best documented of all previous conquests. For the first time in many centuries, the conquest became a subject of intense and widespread historiographical interest, because it was considered to be of acute contemporary relevance. Soon after James's accession in England, he propounded a scheme for union of his two kingdoms. English resistance to this and other alarming projected innovations was often framed in terms of ancient medieval precedent. Selden became one of the leading figures in this resistance. He presented the edition he produced while a political prisoner in the Tower as an innocuous project of antiquarian scholarship, by implicit contrast with the recent book which had aroused his sovereign's ire, his History of Tithes. But the history treated a modern problem historically, with detailed dissection of medieval documentation. The authorities should not have been fooled by Selden's attempts to present the edition of Historia Novorum as disinterested and lacking in contemporary resonance because Eadmer had written half a millennium before. In the 17th century, no investigation of the medieval English past was without its implications for current politics, the conquest most of all, because of what was deemed to be its bearing on what were and what were not the monarch's legitimate powers, particularly his legislative powers. The vast majority of Selden's novel explanatory apparatus to Historia Novorum concerns the opening pages of the book, the pages which dealt with the run-up to and immediate aftermath of the conquest. It appears that Selden was much less interested in commenting on the rest of the text. In response to historically informed opposition and obstruction, James, and Charles I after him, turned increasingly to the medieval past in order to justify their departures from current constitutional convention, to show that they were acting in accord with ancient precedent. The upshot was that the Norman Conquest became an even more controversial topic in the 17th century than it had been in the 12th, when the great histories and legal compilations had first been written. Antithetical interpretations were now debated openly, indeed belligerently. It is not much of an exaggeration to say that they set the terms of current political debate. Certainly they remained central to competing interpretations of the proper extent of royal power down to the aftermath of the Glorious Revolution. The career of the Conquest in the 17th century will be the subject of the second volume of this study. This first volume shows how the materials on which those interpretations were based had come to be written in the 12th century, the various roles which they had played throughout the intervening half millennium, how so many of them were preserved in the catastrophe of the dissolution, and how they had subsequently been disseminated in print to a much wider public. From that point, the mended chain of the early 12th century became a primary cause of disruption as well as of continuity in what turned out to be, in political terms, England's most tumultuous century. 1. The early 12th century perspective in English historical writing. A broken chain. William of Malmesbury's Gesta Regum Anglorum is, by common consent, the most remarkable example of a sudden efflorescence of historical writing in England in the first half of the 12th century. Despite William's conventional, classical protestations of modesty, as distinct from monastic humility, it seems likely that this scholarly consensus endorses his own estimate of his book's importance. His aim, he stated in the prologue, was to mend the broken chain of the times, interruptam temporum seriem sarcire. Perhaps he borrowed the conventional classical metaphor of an historiographical chain from his principal model for an historical prologue, the preface to Justinus's late 2nd or early 3rd century epitome of the Historiae Philippicae of Pompeius Trogus, which was a very popular work in the Middle Ages. But whereas Justinus, and before him Trogus, allegedly in 44 volumes, had aspired to universal coverage, in William's case, the series, otherwise termed cursus temporum, was that of the English people, and he produced two striking variations on the classical metaphor. He elided the writing of the history with the history which was written, and he suggested that the chain had been broken. The break had occurred at the death of Bede, whose Historia Ecclesiastica Gentis Anglorum William conventionally refers to as Gesta Anglorum or Historia Anglorum. In his view, it seems, the subject of Bede's book was simply the history of the English. After Bede, whose death William placed in 734, only the rudimentary vernacular annals, now known collectively as the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, and Athelwood's, to William, painful 10th century attempt to distill some of those annals into Latin, the less said of him the better, saved the period from the dotage of oblivion. During this lengthy hiatus, the cursus temporum limps along without any support from letters. If the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle was indeed a beacon shining bright to keep my course from straying, it was so only by contrast with the otherwise inspissated gloom. William would doubtless have concurred with V.H. Galbraith's judgment. Not much research was needed for these annals, and less learning. Among other early 12th century English historians, William expressed most admiration for Eadmer of Canterbury. Eadmer shared with Bede the quality of a sober style. Nevertheless, Eadmer's Historia Novorum, the first version of which was probably completed by 1114, had, in William's view, skated briskly over the period from Edgar in the third quarter of the 10th century to William the Conqueror, in order to concentrate on recent events. It had not filled the post-Beden gap because it was primarily contemporary history. Hence the need to mend the broken chain or thread, linear, to bring forcibly into light things lost in the rubbish heap of the past. And hence William's private satisfaction, as he concludes his book, that after Bede, I am the only person, or the first, to set in order the continuous history of the English. Quod continuam Anglorum historiam ordinaverim post bedam vel solus vel primus. Like Henry of Huntingdon, another 12th century historian who expresses a reverence for Bede, his authority is incontestable, firmissima. William is emphatic about establishing the continuity of English history by re-establishing the continuity of English historical writing. To do so would be to follow in the footsteps of Bede, who had set out to do something similar for the period between the arrival of the English in Britain and his own day. By implication at least, the arrival of the Normans was an event of comparable magnitude. In William's view, continuity in the writing of English history had been broken not just at, but by, Bede's death. With Bede was buried almost all historical record down to our own day. Where historical writing in Latin was concerned, English monks during these four centuries were indeed, as James Campbell has observed, for the most part inert, certainly by comparison with authorial activity in contemporary Francia or Italy or Spain. When, quite exceptionally, the biography of a West Saxon king was written, it was by a Welsh author who had perhaps become well-read in Wales, though not as well-read in the classics as his Carolingian contemporaries. For reasons into which it is impossible to delve here, English monks appear to have concentrated much more single-mindedly on pastoral and homiletic writings than their continental counterparts. The point can be well illustrated by their use of Bede's Historia Ecclesiastica. Insofar as they continued to show any interest even in him, they tended to refer to the late 9th century Old English translation, which is striking, amongst other things, for its lack of concern with preserving Bede's detailed historical narrative, and for being less interested than Bede had been in the existence of the English as a single people. In the vernacular, Bede's history became instead a source for sermonising. Athelwood was for William a pre-Conquest exception which proved the rule, in that he had attempted to record major events, chiefly by rendering a version of the Anglo-Saxon chronicle into Latin. But he was also an exception in that, when he turned from the chronicle to Bede, he used Bede's original as well as the Old English translation. Perhaps he did so because the original could be made more germane to his contention that, as a result of the Anglo-Saxons' conquest in the 5th century, Britain is now called Anglia, assuming the name of the victors. And they themselves are possessors down to the present day. Had William been capable of overcoming his disgust at Athelwood's style, he might well have felt a considerable affinity with his sentiments. William was, in any case, intent on contrasting his historical writing with the antecedent void which he had identified. In doing so, he articulated a theme, the continuous history of the English, which he shared not only with Henry of Huntingdon, but also with all the other major historians who make the early 12th century the greatest period of English historical writing about England. Eadma, John, preceded by his account by Florence of Worcester, Simeon of Durham, and in a different vein, because he wrote in French verse, primarily for a lay audience, Geoffrey Gaimard. Yet none of these authors, including those other professed admirers of Bede, Henry of Huntingdon and Simeon of Durham, explicitly states that he shares William's view that the death of Bede had brought the writing of English history to an abrupt halt which had persisted for almost four centuries. Although they could not have been unaware of the hiatus, they do not explicitly refer to it. Yet for all of them, a fortiori William of Malmesbury, the continuous history of the English meant something more than continuity in the writing of English history. According to Henry of Huntingdon, for instance, it meant the continuous existence of what was originally the Kingdom of Wessex. The kingdom had been established in 519 with Cherditch's victory over the native British at Chafford, and in course of time it subjected all others to itself and obtained the monarchy of all Britain. Thereafter, thus transformed, it had persisted down to this day. It was not so much the history of a people as the history of a kingdom. This process of political unification under the West Saxon kings professedly provided Henry with the chronological structure for his history. On account of this, the dates of all the other kingdoms are measured relative to those kings. He scarcely bothered with incarnational dates. Although continuous, this teleological process had been anything but smooth. The English conquest of Britain had been the third of five Old Testament-style plagues inflicted on the island by divine providence, the first two being respectively the Roman and Pictish/Scottish invasions. The Danish raids of the 9th to 11th centuries constituted the fourth. The fifth was the Norman conquest, by which God exterminated the English race, or took away from the English race their safety and honour, and even commanded that they should not be a people. In the year of grace, 1066, the Lord, the ruler, brought to completion what he had long planned for the English race, Gens. For he delivered them up for extermination to the violent and cunning race of Normans. The conquest was, in other words, the worst of the five successive providential plagues. But while it might have exterminated the English as a people, although despite the literal meaning of the much-repeated term he hinted perhaps not forever, it did not destroy the unified English kingdom, and therefore the power of that kingdom's king. On the contrary, William I had turned out to be more powerful than any of the kings of the English. The kingdom and its king continued, flourished as never before, even if it was doubtful to what extent the English people might be deemed to have survived. Henry constructed an epilogue to give the impression that he had completed the book in the 69th year from the coming into England in our times of the most excellent Norman race, the 703rd year from the coming into England of the English, the 2265th year from the coming of the Britons to settle in the same island, the 5137th year from the beginning of the world, the 1135th year of grace. The conquest was the latest in a sequence of providential events. Henry's observation about the exercise of royal power deserved to be taken seriously. As befits an historian commissioned by Alexander, Bishop of Lincoln, the nephew of Roger, Bishop of Salisbury, who became in effect the king's chief minister in the 1120s, Henry reveals that he was privy to many confidential details about the royal administrative machine. Moreover, Henry had, so he tells us, spent his youth in the household of Robert Bluet, Bishop of Lincoln, who had previously been the king's chief minister through much of the reigns of William Rufus and Henry I. None of the early 12th century historians, not even Neadma, as amanuensis of Anselm, Archbishop of Canterbury, knew better how English royal government operated from the inside. The conquest had punished the English, but Providence's fashioning of a united English kingdom under a single monarch, starting with the Saxon victory over the natives of Albion in 519, had not been in vain. Indeed, in some ways, particularly the ruthless Norman exploitation of royal government, which Henry described largely in deprecatory terms borrowed from the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, the conquest had consummated it. The immediate inspiration for Henry's interpretation of the conquest as providentially pestilential was scriptural, but it was also a lesson that Henry thought he had drawn from Bede's Historia, which he was said to have rendered more incisive and orderly. His interpretation of the conquest is more overtly schematic than William of Malmesbury's. But William, perhaps also schematizing and simplifying Bede's understanding of the workings of Providence, likewise attributes the conquest, in some respects, to recent failings on the part of the English, which had been justly punished. Many of the English clergy had lapsed into ignorance, and many gluttonous, sottish nobles, gratifying their carnal lusts during the day in the connubial bed, scarcely lent half an ear to incompetent priests gabbling their way through the mass outside the bedchamber door, left ajar to facilitate a simultaneous sacrilegious gesture at devotion. As William reported, Wolfston, Bishop of Worcester, soon the only survivor of the Edwardian hierarchy, had been a striking exception to the general rule that English priests sing the mass cursorily in the morning and then spend the rest of the day intent on food and profit, and in the case of certain Canterbury monks, still more reprehensible pursuits. and Wolfstan himself told some whinging Englishman that they had had it coming. "It is the scourge of God that you are suffering." It made no difference that not every single Englishman had become a thoroughly bad lot by 1066. In the hour of captivity, God's stern judgment sometimes grips the good as well as the bad. Divine justice on this scale was bound to involve collateral damage. It was God's hidden and wonderful purpose that never again should Englishmen breathe together and fight together in defence of their liberties, as if all the strength of England had fallen away with Harold. England might aspire to breathe in liberty, the empty shadow of which she has pursued for so long, but in truth there seemed no prospect of relief. Nowadays she groans under the affliction of calamities. Yet William is far too subtle an historian to characterise the conquest straightforwardly as a biblical pestilence. His analysis of it is nuanced to the point of ambivalence. This was certainly deliberate, but it was facilitated by his forgivable failure ever to reconcile his understanding of providence with that of classical fortuna, which he invokes as frequently as one would expect such a well-read author to do. That he never even addressed the issue directly was testimony to his unerosian sense of the opacity of the workings of providence in the world, and his desire to mimic the ancients in their frequent invocations of fortuna as a determining force in mundane affairs. The 14th of October 1066, the date of the Battle of Hastings, had been a fatal day for England, a deadly disaster for our sweet homeland, as she exchanged new lords for old. No Englishman today is an earl, a bishop, or an abbot. New arrivals everywhere gnaw at England's riches and entrails, nor is there any hope of ending this wretchedness. And yet, the standard of religion, dead everywhere in England, has been raised by the Normans' arrival. This raising of religious standards, together with an expansion in the number of monks, had a striking physical manifestation, to which William displayed more of a sensibility than the other early 12th century historians. You may see everywhere churches in villages, in towns and cities, monasteries rising in a new style of architecture. When William adapted Coleman's Old English Life of Bishop Wolfstan, eventually the sole survivor of the English hierarchy, he recorded, on the basis of the testimony of Prior Nicholas of Worcester, that Wolfstan had wept at the demolition of the old cathedral church. Wolfstan regretted that the work of saints was thereby destroyed. Nevertheless, he acknowledged the necessity for rebuilding. Indeed, he had instigated it. In that respect, he was no different from the many continental clerics by whom the English hierarchy had been so brutally replaced. God had preserved Wolfstan to see the church so exalted. That, quite exceptionally, he had been spared turned out to have been providential for the Church of Worcester. The exaltation or restoration of the English church entailed rebuilding every important English church in the continental Romanesque style, as the Normans recreated England in their own architectural image. Edward the Confessor's new Romanesque Abbey Church at Westminster was the unique exception. No current English cathedral contains any surviving pre-Conquest masonry above ground. In this striking physical sense, too, it is clear that for William of Malmesbury, the Conquest represented what was potentially a major rupture in the continuity of English history, as it was in other senses for him and Henry of Huntingdon. William considered it neater if he started the second book of Wolfstan's Vita at the beginning of the time of the Normans, rather than with Wolfstan's election as bishop in 1062, as Coleman had reportedly done. To William's mind, unlike Coleman's, even a saint's vita should be organised around the distinction between the time of the English and the time of the Normans. True, the Norman reform of English religious life might be interpreted not as a rupture, but a restoration of that refulgent standard of religious observance described by Bede, which had come to prevail in England in the immediate aftermath of the conversion. In that sense, reform under the Normans was a positive development, though to see it as such was to create a tension not only with his view of the sufferings of the English as a result of the conquest, but also with that sense of ineluctable decline which William had absorbed from Bede and from certain Roman historians, a digest of whose writings survives partly in his hand. History, he loftily opined, should be written in the Roman fashion. Yet even with regard to post-conquest religious life, William's ambivalence is at times so arch that it verges on sarcasm. William the Conqueror had canonically deposed some prelates for certain unspecified reasons and replaced them with men of any nationality other than English. He was driven to this, unless I am mistaken, by their ingrained prejudice against the king, for the Normans have a natural kindliness which predisposes them to foreigners living in their midst. According to Gesta Regum, therefore, it was the hostility of the English which drove this kindly new king reluctantly to deny ecclesiastical preferment to English clerics. The restoration of English religious life entailed both the elimination of the existing English hierarchy and their replacement with foreigners. If, therefore, it reconnected with the exemplary religious life of the period just after the conversion, before the English had become corrupt, then that newly re-established continuity was attenuated by what William had previously cited as one of the most striking manifestations of discontinuity, the disappearance of Englishmen from high office. In his Gesta Pontificum Anglorum, written in parallel with his Gesta Regum, he was sometimes, perhaps partly under the influence of Veadma, more blunt about decline. He denounced the conqueror's improper interference in ecclesiastical matters as one aspect of his tyrannical treatment of the English, but added, in unresolved counterpoint, that the religious life of monks rose splendidly. Even so, there still seems to have been little reason for celebration by his own day, at least with respect to royal treatment of the church. Henry I's behaviour, encouraged rather than denounced by his fawning bishops, reduced William to despair. No hope remains, nothing is left. Henry of Huntingdon was less sinuously oblique than William usually is, perhaps because he was content to be more dependent on the lugubriously laconic Anglo-Saxon chronicle. It was an insult even to be called English. The chain of English historical writing might have been broken by Bede's death, but William, like the other early 12th century historians of England, implicitly viewed the conquest as potentially the weakest link in the continuous history of the kingdom. Indeed, their various historical writings attempted to forge that link anew. With the exception of Eadma's Historia Novorum, this is demonstrated in the crudest terms by the amount of space which they devote to pre-conquest England. In the case of Henry of Huntingdon, 2/3 of his book. Even Gaimar, commissioned in the mid-1130s by Constance, wife of the Lincolnshire Baron Ralph Fitzgilbert, and clearly writing for a lay aristocratic Francophone audience, devoted thousands of lines to an indefatigable verse adaptation of the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, the compilation of which he attributed to the initiative of King Alfred, who he claimed had arranged for a chained copy to be kept at Winchester Cathedral for ready public reference. Indeed, he reported that he had consulted it himself. By the early 12th century, interest in the old English past was clearly not confined to natives giving voice to nostalgic laments or to the cloister. Gaimar spiced up this account of English history with more overtly legendary material, such as stories about Havelock the Dane, and more recently Hereward the Wake. He evoked the sort of themes which he thought suitable to a history in the new imported vernacular intended primarily for a lay audience. The love affairs and the courting, the drinking and the hunting, the festivities and the pomp and ceremony, the acts of generosity and the displays of wealth, the entourage of nobles and valiant knights that the king maintained. By contrast, he gave ecclesiastical matters very short shrift. Despite the meretricious elaboration, it is remarkable that his Anglo-Norman lay aristocratic audience found the historical longueurs about Old England entertaining to listen to, for these constitute the bulk of the surviving histoire. This book is not fiction or fantasy, but is taken from an authentic historical source concerning the kings of the past and tells of those who ruled over England. Lincolnshire in the early 12th century may have afforded few distractions for the Francophone elite. Constance Fitzgilbert evidently turned to history to pass the time, and often read in her chamber the poet David's, now lost, vernacular history of Henry I's reign, which had been commissioned by his second wife, Queen Adeliza. It is nevertheless striking that they were willing to while away the long evenings listening to this sort of thing. Differently put, it is remarkable that the first extant history book written in French was a history of England, chiefly pre-Conquest England, written in Northern England in verse. When Gaimard eventually got beyond the Conquest, he presented the English, notably the rebel Hereward the Wake, as chivalrous heroes, a nobleman, un gentilhomme, whom the Normans had disinherited, and William I as a treacherous schemer, just like his Norman followers. This was the sort of account of post-Conquest events which he knew his lay Anglo-Norman audience would lap up. Presumably he assumed that they did not want to hear yet another recapitulation of the justice of the conqueror's cause. But by this point his very long poem was in any case almost at an end. For English and French, cleric and layman and woman alike, it seems, the cataclysmic stimulus of the conquest had within a few decades prompted historical investigation in the English past of a quality and intensity unparalleled anywhere else in medieval Europe, and it was overwhelmingly concerned with England prior to the conquest. Hence, too, the resurgence in the copying of the original Latin bede in England in the late 11th and 12th centuries, after a very long fallow period. It is striking that many of these new copies had to be made from continental exemplars, imported into England for the purpose. There were not enough English manuscripts of the book around to meet the sudden increase in demand. Bede himself may not have been particularly concerned with the history of the English as a people, but it was easier to adapt his original Latin text to such a story than the Old English translation, which had excised much of the material in the original that could have been made germane to it. In the 12th century, the Historia Ecclesiastica Gentis Anglorum could begin to take on the role which some modern commentators have erroneously attributed to it in the 8th, of prophesying the coming to pass of a providentially ordained United Kingdom for God's chosen English people. This is most obviously true of Henry of Huntingdon, who, as we have seen, was said by a 12th century commentator at Lübeck to have made Bede more systematic. That is one way of putting it. But as we have also seen, William of Malmesbury claimed in the conclusion of Gesta Regum that he had been the first writer since Bede to follow Bede's example in setting in order the continuous history of the English. Co-opting Bede rendered incontestable the continuity in English history and its writing up, which constituted the principal message of the early 12th century historians. Mending the chain of English historical writing broken by Bede's death necessarily involved restoring the continuity of English history, the most serious disruption, the weakest link of which, had been occasioned recently by the conquest. Reconnecting English historical writing meant reconnecting English history. But what explains the precise timing of this unprecedented and unparalleled phenomenon? What prompted, 30 or 40 years after 1066, and almost simultaneously in so many different locations in England, the sudden outbreak of this concentrated, collaborative, historiographical endeavour? By William of Malmesbury's account, there had been nothing like it before in England. There has certainly not been since. This handful of writers determined the shape of English history ever after. Much has been written by modern historians about the 12th century Renaissance, but it is impossible to think of a comparable phenomenon anywhere else in 12th century Europe. The stimulus to mend the chain. Writing in the first decade of the 12th century, an author of apparently continental extraction, who would subsequently become one of the select band of historians of England, reveals that this newfound interest in Bede was more than just an intellectual conceit on the part of a very small, exceptionally well-read elite. Simeon of Durham reported that Aldwin, a monk of Winchcombe, had in the early 1070s been so inspired by what he had learnt from Bede's Historia Anglorum about the monasteries which had once flourished in the kingdom of Northumbria, that after recruiting two followers, one English, one Norman, from Evesham Abbey, he had set out for the northern fastnesses and had re-established monastic life in the ruins of Bede's twinned communities of Monk Wearmouth and Jarrow. Simeon emphasises that this bibliophilic monastic revivalist had loaded up the trio's solitary donkey with books. From the twinned cenobial redoubts which Aldwyn went on to resurrect came the monks who in 1083 replaced the secular canons at Simeon's own cathedral church of Durham. The establishment of monastic life in the church where Bede's relics now lay close by those of Cuthbert, whose Vita Bede had written twice, once in prose and once in verse, King Oswald, a central figure in the Historia Ecclesiastica, and Aidan, also a key figure, was to be attributed ultimately to the inspiration of Bede's Historia. That inspiration was twofold. It was Bishop William of St. Calais' reading of Bede, which had prompted him to install in Durham the monks, whose recently established presence in Monk Wearmouth Jarrow had been attributed to Aldwyn's reading of Bede. The providential proximity of monkish recruits and the episcopal determination to redeploy them in Durham could both be credited to a work of English history written 350 years previously, to what was, at the time, still the most recent, indeed the sole, serious work of English history. Bede's Historia and his prose Vita Sancti Cadberti proved that the see, now relocated to Durham, was that originally founded on Lindisfarne in the 7th century by St. Aidan, at the invitation of King Oswald. This was the very church over which Cuthbert had come to preside during his lifetime. Durham even possessed one of Cuthbert's own books, found on his chest when his tomb was opened in 1104, as well as the miraculously preserved Lindisfarne Gospels. Three extant manuscripts in the library at Durham, then as now, bear inscriptions which purport to be in Bede's handwriting. There was once at least one more. After 1099, a very ornate 9th century manuscript, probably from Lindisfarne, in which the names of 9th century monks had been inscribed, began to be reused as the Liber Vitae for the re-established monastic church of Durham. The long-dead brethren it recorded, and those recently deceased at Durham, were all deemed to be members of the same relocated community. In a sense more fundamental than the historiographical, in northeast England it was Bede's Historia which had prompted the mending of the broken chain of monastic living, both in Bede's own community and in the Church of Aidan and Cuthbert. Historical book learning was shown to have had profound effects which were indistinguishably spiritual and institutional. It was responsible for the post-conquest monastic renewal on which William of Malmesbury would lay such stress as he sought to replicate and continue Bede's Historia for his age. It was no surprise that Simeon of Durham made extensive use of the very copy of the Historia which William of St. Calais donated to his cathedral library. To this manuscript was very soon, at the end of the 11th century, appended a short vita of Bede, and then a copy of Bede's Historia Abbatum of Monk Wearmouth Jarrow. In another book, Simeon himself copied Bede's prose and verse vitae of St. Cuthbert, and added hagiographies of Aidan and Oswald, confected on the basis of Historia Ecclesiastica. Another copy of the prose vita of Cuthbert survives in his hand, followed by the earliest extant witness of the anonymous Historia de Sancto Cuthberto. This intensive authorial campaign served to underline the connection between the Church of Durham and the history of Bede's own community in both the distant and the immediate past. As with the different types of historical investigation undertaken to establish the title of particular churches to their lands and rights, or the plausibility of particular English saints, the response to the conquest of historians writing in England in the early 12th century was to reach back beyond it, in many cases far beyond it, in order to demonstrate continuity with Old England. Sometimes the same writers were engaged in all three types of enterprise, most obviously William of Malmesbury and Eadmer, who reveal considerable expertise in diplomatic, and were prolific writers of saints' lives, a genre which, at least in their cases, entailed detailed research in the archives of particular churches. Eadmer knew that Lanfranc required diligent inquiry when he commissioned a saint's life. He had learnt from long experience that the research involved was not easy. With some exaggeration, William claimed that such authors were faced with a dearth of existing English hagiographical material comparable to that of historical writing. In truth, he, like Eadmer, was able to draw directly on earlier hagiographers. But in this case, the explanation was not solely alleged inertia on the part of earlier English hagiographers. The evidence has been destroyed by the violence of enemies, so that knowledge remains only of the names of saints and of any miracles they still perform. In his view, he and a few mainly continental specialists who had recently been at work in England, such as Gosselin of Saint-Bertin, had had to start almost from scratch, and at least one of them, Faricius, the Italian abbot of Abingdon, had been let down by his ignorance of the English language. Faricius had previously been a monk of Malmesbury, so William must have felt that he was in a good position to judge. Doubtless many of the others, with the explicit exception of Gosselin, could not measure up to William's exacting scholarly standards either. He offers no comment on Folcar of Saint-Bertin or on Simeon of Durham, with whom he was nevertheless probably acquainted. Initially complimentary about Osborne of Canterbury, a native exception to the rule that hagiographers were recruited from abroad in the 11th century, William later became inveterately critical of him, just as Eadmer had done a little earlier. Nevertheless, in what William condescendingly regarded as their often slipshod fashion, these authors of predominantly continental origin succeeded in rescuing certain English saints from oblivion. Eadmer himself had learnt the historian's craft in this way, and graduated to writing larger-scale history. The starting point of his more ambitious enterprise was provided by a hagiographical conceit originally coined by Osborne, elaborating a point initially made at Canterbury late in the reign of Athelred II, that the then-current Danish invasions of England were divinely inflicted retribution for the assassination of Edward the Martyr. Eadmer had previously sketched it in his Vita of Dunstan. William, by contrast with Eadmer, had already finished the first draft of his major historical work, Gesta Regum, before he turned his hand to producing hagiography and his De Antiquitate Glastoniae Ecclesiae. Despite the contrast in the sequence of their work, in both cases their hagiographies expressed historical views which were of a piece with their large-scale histories. Saints' lives were necessarily focused on shoring up the bona fides of saints deemed particularly important to a given institution. They were, therefore, not unrelated to the justification of the church's claims to its rights and estates, an exercise in which many churches had been forced to engage since the 1070s at the latest. But it was the former imperative which seems to have provided the most important initial stimulus to the post-Bedon resurrection of historical writing in England. Disputed claims to lands and rights prompted urgent historical investigation, but of a sort which at this preliminary stage did not produce much in the way of historical writing. The primary catalyst for the sudden proliferation of hagiographical and soon historical writing seems rather to have been the programme of rebuilding major English churches, on which William of Malmesbury in particular would soon place so much emphasis. Rebuilding involved the translation of relics into the new church, provided, that is, that the presiding prelate, almost always of continental origin, deemed them worthy of veneration. New Englishmen, preeminently Archbishop Lanfranc, were not willing to take on trust the oral traditions which, within any particular house, appear to have been the predominant pre-Conquest English mode of sustaining the sanctity of its relics. Such claims, much like claims to estates and other rights, now required documentation in Latin in addition to oral testimony, or, where there was some pre-Conquest hagiographical tradition, much more thorough and extensive documentation than hitherto. This might be subject to probing scrutiny. In some instances, the relics themselves were, At Evesham, reportedly on the advice of Lanfranc himself, they were subjected to the ordeal of fire and miraculously passed. It is therefore no surprise that a sudden, novel outburst of hagiographical activity accompanied the programme of rebuilding, as major ceremonial translations of relics began to take place in England for the first time in almost a century. To be more precise, the outburst occurred in the 1080s, 1090s, and 1100s, as rebuilding projects reached the point at which the east ends of the new churches could be brought into liturgical use. Inescapable decisions were therefore prompted about which relics to translate and which, as happened for instance at Malmesbury, to discard as the remains of servile hirelings, so much more rubbish to be cast onto that already being dumped, as rubble from the demolished ancient church at Evesham was into its very crypt. At Malmesbury, to adapt the words which William attributed to a tearful St. Wulfstan at Worcester, it was not just the architectural work of the saints which was obliterated, but their bones too. Warren, the Norman abbot who presided over the building project at Malmesbury, had treated the relics of its old English saints with sacrilegious mockery. "Let the most potent of them come to the rescue of the rest." Although William goes on to report that Warren soon came to see the error of his scepticism. He was persuaded of Aldhelm's sanctity at least, and organised a new translation of his relics. Archbishop Lanfranc went on to promulgate a law, lex, throughout all England, which proclaimed Aldhelm's sanctity. As the slightly earlier example of the cult of Dunstan at Canterbury suggested, no established pre-Conquest saint, however revered and however august the church in which he or she was traditionally venerated, was now above question. When Cuthbert's relics were to be translated into the sanctuary at the east end of the new cathedral church at Durham in 1104, cynics, apparently including that epitome of calculating worldliness, Bishop Ranulf Flambard, insisted on repeated inspections to establish whether Cuthbert's body really was, as had been claimed by Durham monks, miraculously incorrupt. The visiting abbot of Sées was enlisted to subject it to an independent and, as it turned out, vigorous examination, including pulling one ear back and forth in no gentle manner, and manhandling it by the head into a sitting position, shaking it as he held it. Like everyone else, Bishop Ranulf was convinced by the demonstration. He responded by preaching at interminable length. In Cuthbert's case, doubts appear to have been limited to tales of the miraculous endorsement of the authenticity of the alleged remains. They did not extend to his sanctity. But of course, if the relics had not been authentic, then no benefit could accrue from their veneration, and Cuthbert's intercession would be sought in vain in Durham. Some miracle stories about Cuthbert had probably been written up prior to the translation, others were demonstrably inspired by it. According to William of Malmesbury, the saint himself had signalled when he was ready to be translated by making the timber supports for the vaulting in the new presbytery collapse in the middle of the night. The importance of Cuthbert's relocated relics in the subsequent life of the community prompted the recasting and elaboration of the, for pre-Conquest England, exceptionally plentiful existing hagiographical material. Elsewhere, rejection could extend to those traditionally revered for reasons other than sanctity. The first post-Conquest abbot of St. Albans from Normandy refused to allow the remains of the abbey's uncanonised legendary founder, King Offa, into the new church. He also destroyed the tombs of previous abbots. Not every rebuilding of a major church is known to have triggered new hagiographies and ceremonial translations. An almost unremarked aspect of the relocation of certain sees, determined at the Council of London in 1075, is the apparent absence of major pre-Conquest cults at any of the churches involved. The only arguable exception is that of St. Wulfseger, Bishop of Sherborne, whose Vita Gosselin wrote and dedicated to an anonymous bishop, almost certainly Osmond. Osmond became bishop in 1078, shortly after the see had been relocated to Old Sarum, but remained abbot of the now dependent priory at Sherborne, where the monks stayed. Perhaps because Wulfseger's body was left behind at Sherborne, There is no evidence that Gusland's Vita was inspired by or presaged a new translation to Old Sarum. This attempt to rekindle Wolfseger's pre-Conquest cult proved unsuccessful. Once the relocation had taken place, the remote Sherburn appears soon to have ceased to be a focus of close episcopal interest. Maybe Gosselin had been disappointed. He was unjustly scathing about the state of learning in the Church of Old Sarum under Bishop Osmond. Osmond seems to have been much more interested in his far earlier predecessor, Aldhelm. But Aldhelm's relics had been kept at various locations within the precincts of Malmesbury Abbey ever since his death, and Osmond himself had officiated at their most recent translation in 1078. He would later catch Aldhelm's left arm bone off Warren, the abbot who had initially been so notoriously contemptuous of the relics of English saints, but had come round in the case of Aldhelm. An arm bone was never going to be sufficient to engender a new cult of Aldhelm at Old Sarum. There was great interest in hagiography at Old Sarum, but the copy made there of a standard collection of saints' lives included none associated with that church, and very few English saints. Other than Gosselin's Vita Sancti Wulfsigi, which was focused on the dependent priory of Sherburn rather than the new cathedral at Old Sarum, it is striking that none of the sees relocated after 1075 is known to have produced hagiographies in this period, and there are no records of consequent translations of relics from the old locations to the new. This may mean no more than that the local saints venerated at these churches failed, on post-conquest investigation, to pass muster. Certainly distance of relocation in itself had not previously been a bar to translation. Cuthbert, Aidan, Oswald and Bede all ended up together in the east end of the new cathedral at Durham, thereby showing that saints' relics could be serially peripatetic and nevertheless prosper. The absence of translations in the relocated sees demonstrates that in these cases the prompt which proved so productive of historical investigation elsewhere was lacking. The care taken to establish that they were the same sees continued, not new foundations, and that the traditional ranking of English sees remained unaltered by the programme of relocation shows that there was very considerable interest in demonstrating historical continuity in these particular institutions. It is therefore all the more striking that none of these churches inspired much in the way of English hagiography in this period, or went on to produce any of the great history books of the early 12th century. Henry of Huntingdon's Historia may appear to be an exception to this rule, because it was written in the Diocese of Lincoln. But the appearance is illusory. One book contains potted lives of saints drawn mainly from Bede, supplemented with brief accounts of a few modern saints based on a wide variety of recent hagiographies. Other than Birinus, none has any Dorchester or Lincoln connection, and Birinus's cult had, as we have seen, been a Winchester phenomenon for centuries. Henry mentions only two translations, of St. Alban in 1129 and of St. Athelthryth at Ely in 1106. There is no indication that Henry, a secular clerk and diocesan administrative official, was inspired to write history by hagiographical research conducted at Lincoln or anywhere else. In a negative sense, therefore, the sees relocated after 1075 corroborate the importance which I have attributed to the post-conquest rebuilding of major churches and the translation of relics as catalysts for investigation of the pre-conquest past. Elsewhere, the association between the three phenomena of rebuilding, translation and hagiography assumes something approaching a regularity in the 1090s. The first documented major ceremonial post-conquest translation, more accurately translations, took place at St. Augustine's, Canterbury, in September 1091, a week-long spectacle which seems to have been promoted, at least in part, by a desire to defuse the violent and persistent resistance of English monks to the imposition of Wido as abbot. If Wido's intentions were irenic, the manner of implementation does not seem best calculated to soothe affronted English sensibilities. The surviving north porticus of St. Gregory in the Anglo-Saxon church of St. Peter and Paul begun by Augustine himself, was demolished even before the relics of Augustine and his five immediate successors as archbishop, together with the 8th century Nothelm, could be translated. They had to be extracted from the rubble before being reverently conveyed into the new church which Abbot Scolland, Wido's predecessor, had started to construct in the 1070s. An account of the translations, together with short and long versions of the Vita and Miracula of Augustine, survives in a contemporary collection of hagiographies written by Gosselin of Saint-Bertin, who had probably just been appointed as precentor of the abbey in order to orchestrate the ceremony. There is no suggestion in this instance that there were any doubts about the sanctity of the relics, and by Gosselin's own account, he did not write up the translations until 7 years after the event. But it was evidently felt necessary that Augustine's life and miracles, and those of the other saints, should now be rewritten. Gosselin was soon seconded to perform a similar job at Barking Abbey, which had close links to St. Augustine's. The abbey church there was rebuilt under Abbess Alfgifu, another quite exceptional Old English survivor in the Wulfstanian mode. Gosselin composed vitae of the early Barking saints Athelber, Hildelith, and the late 10th century Wulfhild, together with accounts of the translations of their relics into the grandiose new church. At Winchester, on St. Swithin's feast day, 1093, the monks carried the saints' reliquary from the Old Minster into the new cathedral. The demolition of the Old Minster began on the following day, though the site of Swithin's now empty grave in the demolished Old Minster was carefully preserved as the focus of an outdoor memorial court. Walkerlin, the bishop under whom the rebuilding project reached this consummation, had been closely involved in the recent episode at St. Augustine's, and his huge new cathedral revealed its architectural influence. It is unlikely to be a coincidence that sometime in the 1090s, an unidentifiable hagiographer who had access to the archives at Winchester wrote a new Vita and probably Miracula of Swithin, which drew on the pre-Conquest material, exceptionally rich at Winchester, as at Durham and Canterbury. Whether or not one or both works had been completed to accompany the translation, they were evidently prompted by the wholesale physical renewal of the church, dedicated, after St. Peter and Paul, to the saint. Although their author understood English, he was francophone. He had started writing at Sherborne, where there could not have been much call for his hagiographical talents, so he was not, or at least not initially, a Winchester monk. Rather, he was another peripatetic specialist writer of continental origin, in the mould of Gosselin or Folcart, recruited to perform a service of which no one then at Winchester was presumably deemed capable. This was the role that Simeon brought over from Normandy by William.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.